We know that an angle is formed when two rays have a common endpoint. So these two rays come together, they have a common endpoint to form this angle. Again, in this case, this ray and this ray come together and meet at this common endpoint to form this angle. Now this common endpoint, is called the vertex of the angle. So it is called the vertex of the angle, and the rays which come together to form the angle are called the arms of the angle. So the common endpoint is the vertex and the rays are the arms of the angle. So in this case, this and this are the vertex, these two are the arms of this angle, and these two are the arms of this angle. Now how do we name an angle? Well, we name any geometrical figure using points. So first let us name this point at the vertex. Say we call it point A. Now we take a point on this arm, call it point B. We take a point on the other arm and call it point C. So I can call this angle BAC or I can also write it as angle CAB, angle CAB. But can we write it as angle ABC? Can we write this angle as angle ABC? No, we can never write it as angle ABC because the point which is at the vertex has to be written in the center. So the point at the center represents the vertex. So I can never represent this angle as angle ABC. Also, instead of writing this angle again and again, we use a symbol, that is angle BAC. So this is the symbol we use for denoting angle. So instead of writing angle again and again, we can use this symbol. So we can write angle BAC. Also note that this symbol has nothing to do with the shape of the angle. The angle may be an obtuse angle, a right angle, a reflex angle. This symbol is always written in this manner. It will never change. So this symbol is always written in this manner, whatever may be the shape of the angle. Also, we know that angles are formed when lines meet and also when line segments meet. So this angle is formed when these two lines meet. This angle is formed when these two line segments meet. And this angle is formed when these two rays meet. So it is not necessary that angles will be formed by rays only. They may be formed by lines or line segments as well. So now, can you tell me which is the correct way of naming this angle? So which of these is the correct way of naming this angle? Well, angle YZX. We see that Y is the vertex of this angle, so it has to be written in the center. But in this case, point Z is written in the center. So this is not the correct way of naming this angle. Angle ZYX. Angle ZYX. Yes, this is a correct way of naming this angle. What about this? Angle ZYX. We see that the letters are written in the correct order. Angle Z, Y, X, they are written in the correct order. But the symbol, this symbol, which denotes an angle, is incorrect. We never draw the symbol like this. It is always drawn in this manner. So even this is incorrect. So this is the correct way of naming this angle. Now the region that lies within an angle is called the interior of the angle. So if we look at this angle, angle ABC, this region, this entire green shaded region is the interior of angle ABC. We see that this region extends indefinitely. It extends forever and forever. Even if the angle is made up of line segments, we see that this angle is made up of line segment AB and line segment BC. These line segments are of finite length, but still, in this case as well, the interior of the angle extends infinitely. It extends forever. There is no end where it will stop. So this entire green shaded region is the interior of angle ABC. And any point in this region is said to be in the interior of angle ABC. So we say that point M is in the interior of angle ABC. So point M is in the interior of angle ABC. So this green shaded region is the interior of angle ABC. Now these are two roads. These two roads form this angle. So these houses, these buildings can be considered to be in the interior of these two roads. Or we can say that all these buildings are in the interior of this angle. So these buildings are in the interior of this angle. Now if there is an interior, there must be something called an exterior as well. What is an exterior of an angle? The region that lies outside the angle is called the exterior of the angle. So again, this green shaded region, this entire board, except for this part, this is the exterior of the angle. The exterior of the angle also extends indefinitely. It doesn't stop. It extends forever. So the entire space outside this angle is the exterior of the angle. And any point in this part, this like this point, is said to be in the exterior of angle ABC. So we say that point M is in the exterior of angle ABC. So again, if we see that these two roads form this angle, then all these buildings, they lie in the exterior of this angle. Now, what if we consider this angle? Will the exterior remain the same? No. If we consider this angle, then these buildings here, they are in the interior of this angle. Only these buildings are in the exterior of this angle. So exterior and interior are specific to an angle. It varies depending on the angle. So we have talked about this part, we have talked about this part. But what about these cars? If we consider this angle, what about these cars which are traveling on these two roads? Are they in the interior or are they in the exterior? Well, they are neither in the interior nor in the exterior. They are said to be on the boundary of the angle. So the boundary of the angle is made up of all the points which lie on the arms of the angle. So if we consider this angle, angle ABC, all the points which lie on the arms of the angle. So these points, they are, all these points, they are said to be on the boundary of angle ABC. So now, can you tell me, where does point B lie? Well, we can clearly see that point B lies on the arms of the angle. It lies on QR, which is the arm of the angle. So it is said to be on the boundary of angle PQR. Now the interior region of the angle, which is the green shaded region, plus the boundary of the angle, that is arms AB and arms BC, constitute the angular region. So the interior region plus the boundary constitutes the angular region. Together, these two make the angular region. Now the size of an angle is the amount of turn required to go from the initial position to the final position. So consider this to be the initial position. Now the amount of turn required to go from this initial position to the final position is called the size of the angle. Let us see what we mean by this. Now this is the initial position. From this initial position, we go to this final position. So the size of the angle is given by this turn. More the turn, greater will be the angle. So if I increase the turn, the size of the angle will increase. If I decrease this turn, the size of the angle will decrease. So the size of the angle is the amount of turn required to go from the initial position to the final position. And more turns means a greater angle. So we see that the measurement of an angle does not depend upon the length of the arms of the angle, because it depends on the amount of turn required to go from the initial to the final position. So it does not depend on the length of the arms of the angle. So even if I increase the length of the arms, even if I increase the length of the arms, the amount of turn remains the same and this angle remains as 60 degrees. If I decrease the length of the arms, so if I decrease the length of the arms, the amount of turn still remains the same and the angle remains 60 degrees. So it does not depend upon the length of the arms. It simply depends on the amount of turn. Now we know that one complete turn or one complete rotation is equal to 360 degrees. So it is divided into 360 equal parts. Each of these equal parts is called a degree. Now, 1 degree is further divided into 60 equal parts. Each of these equal parts is called a minute, and 1 minute is further divided into 60 equal parts. And each of these equal parts is called a second. So one complete rotation is 360 degrees. 1 degree is equal to 60 minutes. 1 minute is equal to 60 seconds. So these are the standard units of measuring an angle. Do not get confused here. These minutes and seconds have nothing to do with the minutes and seconds of time. They are just smaller and smaller parts of degree. So these minutes and seconds have nothing to do with time. They are just smaller parts of degree. And how do we measure an angle? We measure an angle using a protractor. And this is how a protractor looks like. So we measure an angle using this instrument called protractor. You can see several divisions on this protractor. From here to here, it is 0 to 10. This distance is 10 degrees. Again, from 10 to 20 is 10 degrees. And these small divisions represent 1 degree.